Hi everybody, it's Rishi Agarwal. In this video, I'm going to show you the normal postoperative appearance of each lobectomy on CT. Sometimes residents have trouble figuring out which lobe is gone, so I'm going to show you how to figure it out just by looking at the surgical clip line. In this video, we're not going to talk about segmentectomy, wedge resection, or sleeve lobectomies, which I'll leave for another time, only simple lobectomies. You should know that most of the time when a patient gets a lobectomy, it's going to be for lung cancer. Occasionally, there's some rare infections or other conditions that might lead a surgeon to remove a whole lobe, but for the most part, lung cancer is going to be the reason. I'm going to show you examples of each lobectomy, but let me just say right off the bat that there's no real secret to figuring out which surgery it was. It all comes from knowing the lobar and segmental anatomy and where the bronchi are supposed to arise. So if you need a refresher on that, check out the link on the top right. If you're already good to go with the lobar and segmental anatomy, then keep watching. Also in this video, I'm going to focus on the airways and lungs. I will touch on the vascular supply a little bit, but that's not going to be the focus. Here's the first example, which is a right upper lobectomy. These two images on the right are from the preoperative CT, and these two images on the left are from the postoperative CT. All right, let's start with the trachea and follow it down. So this right here is the trachea, and I'm scrolling down. And as we scroll down, we run into the carina and right and left main bronchi. Remember that the right upper lobe bronchus is the first bronchus arising from the right main bronchus. But in this case, as we scroll, all we have is this stump, which comes to a point. And if we go to the bone windows, you can see that there's a staple line right at the tip of that stump, which is where the right upper lobe should be. So how do we know that this is the right upper lobe bronchus and not the right middle lobe bronchus? Well, the right upper lobe bronchus comes off kind of at the level of the carina or maybe just below it. So if this were a middle lobectomy, this bronchial stump right here would be way farther down. Notice the preoperative CT, the right upper lobe bronchus, which is right here, comes off at approximately the same level as the carina. The other reason why we know it's not the right middle lobe bronchus is that if we follow it down, we now are in the bronchus intermedius, and the bronchus intermedius divides into anteriorly the right middle lobe bronchus and posteriorly the right lower lobe bronchus. On these coronal images, you could see the trachea and the division into the right main and left main bronchus. And then where the right upper lobe bronchus should be, right at the level of the carina, there is a staple line. And you can see it pretty clearly on the coronal images. Okay, I want to show you the lung parenchyma and the fissures. On the axials, you can see that the right middle lobe, which is here, has expanded and it's migrated superiorly to take the place of where the anterior and apical segments of the right upper lobe used to be. The other thing to note is that there will typically be staple lines along the margins of the remaining lobes. And the reason why you'll see that is because frequently these fissures, and in fact 80% of the time, the minor fissure is not complete. So to properly divide one lobe from the adjacent lobe without having an air leak, the margins have to be stapled shut. Let's take a look at the sagittal images where we can evaluate the fissures. There's a couple things that I want you to note on these preoperative images. One is that the right middle lobe, a part of it touches the diaphragm right here. And then the second thing is that it's faint, but the apex of the major fissure, on the right side, it only comes to about the T5 level. And in this patient, it's even lower, to about the T6 level. Okay, so that means that the superior segment of the lower lobe on the right only comes to about T5 or T6. Now, let's look at the post-op sagittal images. So first of all, you can see that the right middle lobe, which is here, this is all right middle lobe, has come up to occupy the apex, and the bottom of the right middle lobe no longer touches the diaphragm. Okay, so not only is it hyperexpanded, but it's also migrated superiorly. And the anterior aspect of the lower lobe has come anteriorly to fill that space here. And then the second thing is that the major fissure, or the only fissure on the right that's left, it goes all the way up to about the T2 or T3 level now. So where the posterior segment of the right upper lobe used to be, now sits the superior segment of the lower lobe. Now let's take a quick look at the vasculature. The arterial supply to the right upper lobe usually comes from two arteries, one supplying the anterior and apical segments, which is called the truncus anterior, and the other supplying the posterior segment. The truncus anterior is typically easy to see, and if you'll notice, there's this contrast right here, and if we follow it up, it will just stop. So I'll do that again. This little focus of contrast in the middle of this magnifying glass will just come to a stop, and that's the truncus anterior. It's easier to see on the coronal images. Here we have this little stump of the truncus anterior that comes to a point and doesn't go anywhere. In this case, I can't clearly see the stump of the posterior segment. Remember that the veins will also be ligated for a lobectomy. So in this case, the right superior pulmonary vein was partially removed, or branches of it were removed right here. But you could still see that the branches supplying the right middle lobe are still there. Okay, the right upper, or the right superior pulmonary vein supplies both the right upper lobe and the right middle lobe in most cases. Okay, let's move on to the middle lobe. Here's a patient who's had a right middle lobectomy. So again, we're just going to follow the airways down and see what's missing. So we're at carina right here, right main bronchus, left main bronchus. First bronchus to come off is the right upper lobe, so that's there. The bronchus intermedius is here. And as we continue down, the bronchus intermedius divides into this anterior bronchus and a posterior bronchus. If we follow the anterior bronchus, you can see that it just stops. And again, if we go to the bone windows, you'll see that there's a clip line just distal to the bronchial stump. So this is a right middle lobectomy. And here again, you will see staple lines in the remaining margins of the lobes because of the incomplete fissures, and we have a staple line right here. On the sagittal images, this anterior bronchus is the right middle lobe bronchial stump, which just comes to a point. And then you can see that, based on the position of the fissure, that the upper lobe has expanded down and the right lower lobe has expanded anteriorly to fill the relatively small space occupied by the right middle lobe. Usually there are two arteries supplying the right middle lobe that arise from the right interlobar artery, but in this case I could only identify one. And then in terms of veins, usually, as I mentioned before, the right middle lobe gets venous drainage from the right superior pulmonary vein. But in this case, the drainage was from its own right middle pulmonary vein. Okay, that's the normal appearance of a right middle lobectomy. Let's take a look at the right lower lobectomy. In a right lower lobectomy, as you follow the bronchi down, you might see one staple line that covers the origin of the right lower lobe bronchus, or you might see two staple lines, one for the superior segment and the other at the takeoff of the basilar segments. The reason is that oftentimes the superior segment of the right lower lobe comes off pretty high, opposite the right middle lobe bronchus. So to safely remove the lobe, it has to be taken off separately. In this case, I think what we have is a single kind of obliquely oriented staple line that removes both the superior segment and the basilar trunk at the same time. When we look at the lung, you'll see that the right middle lobe bronchus just goes straight down instead of pointing anteriorly. So this is the right middle lobe bronchus here, and as I scroll down, you can see it's just going straight down. It's not pointing anteriorly. And so the right middle lobe expands posteriorly and inferiorly. And we can see that on the sagittal images. This is the remaining fissure here. And the right middle lobe occupies this lower third of the thorax. It's expanded posteriorly here. And the right upper lobe occupies the upper two-thirds of the thorax. The arterial blood supply can be kind of variable in the right lower lobe, but usually there's a superior segmental artery and then a trunk supplying the basilar segments. And then the venous anatomy is pretty straightforward. All you'll have is some clips right where the right inferior pulmonary vein inserts on the left atrium, which is what we have here. Now, I want to show you another case of a right lower lobectomy because sometimes the lobes don't expand in this way. Occasionally, they can expand in another way. So this is another case of a right lower lobectomy, but if we follow the airways down in this case, this is the trachea, carina. This is the right upper lobe bronchus right here, okay? This is the right upper lobe bronchus. And you can see it's taken a posterior position in the thorax. And as we continue down, the right middle lobe retains its sort of anterior inferior position in the chest. Let's take a look at it on the sagittal images. So here on the sagittals, you could see this is the fissure. The right middle lobe kind of remains in its normal spot, but the right upper lobe extends inferiorly to fill the space once occupied by the lower lobe. So we have this situation where the right upper lobe is actually posterior to the right middle lobe. And you won't see this as often as the other configuration, but you will see it from time to time. Let's look at the left lower lobe. Here's a case of a left lower lobectomy. And as we follow the airways, you can see that this anterior bronchus is patent, which is the left upper lobe bronchus. The left lower lobe bronchus is directed posteriorly, and that's what this bronchial stump is here. Now, because there's only two lobes on the left, we don't have any fissures in the left lung after a lobectomy, and the remaining lobe just expands to fill the entire space. And then also you can see that there's been some shift of the mediastinum to the left as well. Now, this case is a little different from the others because of this little bit of tissue right here. So you can see that there's a little bit of soft tissue and fat along the posterior mediastinum here, and it extends to the bronchial stump. And this is an intercostal muscle flap from the fifth intercostal space. And if we go to the fifth intercostal space on the soft tissue windows, you can see that it's pretty bare there. Compare that to the sixth intercostal space where we can see the intercostal muscle and fat in there. And then again, the fifth intercostal space, there's nothing there because it's been mobilized to sort of buttress this bronchial stump. The blood supply is pretty easy. The left interlobar artery sends blood supply to the left lower lobe. It also sends a couple of branches to the lingula. And then the venous drainage is just the left inferior pulmonary vein. And here you can see the clip right there. Let's finish up with the left upper lobe. As we scroll down, we have a bronchial stump here that is directed sort of anteriorly compared to this bronchus, which is posterior. So this is the left lower lobe, and this is the left upper lobe bronchus. And again, because we only have two lobes on the left, there's no residual fissure after a left lobectomy. And on the sagittal images, what we have is that the superior segment has expanded to fill the apical and anterior segments of the left upper lobe, and the anterior segments of the left lower lobe have come forward to fill what was once occupied by the lingula. The arterial supply to the left upper lobe can be highly variable, but the venous supply is pretty simple. The veins drain into the left superior pulmonary vein, and you can see the stump of the left superior pulmonary vein right there. All right, this has been an imaging review of the normal appearance of each lobectomy. If you have any questions about this topic or any other chest radiology topic, let me know in the comments below. Thanks.